Howdy. My name is Zach Sunberg. I'm a professor at the University of Colorado Boulder. And welcome to my JuliaCon 2021 talk on POMDPs.jl and the interactive assignments that I did in Julia in my class. So first, a bit about my class. The course is called Decision Making Under Uncertainty, and it's about all of these different problems that you can make decisions for with algorithms when there's a lot of uncertainty. We focus on Markov decision processes, reinforcement learning, partially observable Markov decision processes, POMDPs, and games. About half the students in this class are Aero students. That's my department, and half of them are CS. Normally, Aero students would be doing homework in MATLAB, and normally the CS students would probably use Python for their homework, but I had them use Julia. And that decision was driven by pretty much one lesson in this course, which was Monte-Carlo tree search, or MCTS. And Monte-Carlo tree search is a really powerful algorithm that constructs a tree that allows you to make far-sighted decisions in Markov decision processes. And it's really powerful. It's one of the components that was part of AlphaGo that beat Lee Sedol at Go a few years ago. And it's really, you can't understand Monte Carlo tree search very well, or you can't understand its power if you implement it in a language like Python or MATLAB, just because it's too slow for you to really see what it can do. So I decided to implement it in Julia. Fortunately, there's a lot of resources for doing this. So maybe the most important one is this book called Algorithms for Decision Making, written by Michael Kokendorfer, Tim Wheeler, and Kyle Ray. And you can find that at algorithmsbook.com. But instead of pseudocode for the algorithms in this book, they just have Julia code. So it makes it perfect for this kind of thing. And here's their implementation of Monte Carlo tree search that my students could kind of start off with on their homework. So before I jump into what the homework assignments look like, I'll talk about POMDPs.jl, which is our interface for POMDP problems, POMDP solvers, and people running POMDP experiments. So there's a lot of challenges for writing a POMDP framework like this. One is POMDPs are computationally difficult. So for this, we use Julia, and that allows us to get the most computation from our hardware. But secondly, there's a huge variety of problems and solvers. There's a lot of dimensions on which these things differ, but I'm just going to talk about one, which is the generative versus explicit problems. So in an explicit problem, you define the entire probability distributions for all outcomes, whereas in a generative or black box definition, you just define a function that, given a state in action, outputs a sampled new state and a reward. So people have tried to make frameworks like this before. One of the popular ones is called APPL, and this is a really great framework written in C++, but they have three different algorithms in it, and those algorithms all use different problem formulations because of this kind of generative versus explicit nature of what different algorithms use. And they even say on their website that at the moment these three packages are independent, and maybe one day we can merge them. And I'm happy to say that we were able to largely do that with POMDPs.jl because of the flexibility of Julia. So this kind of shows a map of how the different interfaces fit together. You have the explicit interface for kind of simpler problems and algorithms that use that, and the generative interface for bigger problems and algorithms that use the generative interface. So let's take a look at a problem definition for that. So if we're going to use this simple mountain car example, in the mountain car MDP, you control this car, you can go either left or right, and you don't have enough power to get up to reach the goal, so you kind of have to go back and forth and build up energy until you can reach the goal. So this is what a definition of that looks like in POMDPs.jl. This is what a generative definition looks like. You define some of the static properties, and then you define a function that takes in a state, an action, and a random number generator, and then output the named tuple with the next state and reward. Or you can define it the same exact thing explicitly by giving a transition function that takes in a state and action, and notably not a random number generator, and then outputs a distribution object that defines the distribution of the next state. So both models give you this gen function, which can generate a new state, a randomly sampled new state. But the explicit model additionally gives you this transition function that gives you the whole transition over all possible next states. And so that contains a lot more information. We can also add visualization, which is pretty easy. You just tack on this render function to what we already had above. And you can use a package like compose to generate an image of this. Then you just define a policy, run a simulation, and then you have this nice sequence of images with only 20, 30 lines of code that can give you an image of how your MDP performed. So that's a simple problem definition, but the great thing about POMDPs.jl is it can scale. So this is a real research problem implemented in POMDPs.jl that is for autonomous lane changing with Monte Carlo research. I also like to show what algorithms kind of look like. So this is the pseudocode for the Despot POMDP algorithm. And this is the C++ implementation. then this is the Julia implementation. So you can see that the pseudocode maps right over to the code. It's super easy to read and share, and it's almost as fast as the C++ implementation. So that's a great tool for research. Let's talk about what homework looks like in this class. So we had a package called DMU student. The students would write their code, and then they would use a function called evaluate from the DMU student package. And this would run their code and see how well it did on the assignment problem. And then that would output a results.json file, which is what they would upload to Gradescope. Okay, let's take a look at what an actual homework assignment looks like. So in this homework assignment, the goal was to write a function called selectAction that would use MCTS to solve a dense grid world problem. So we can load the problem from the DMU student package, create MDP, and then load this dummy function, which I don't have the solution here for you right now, but this one just is a dumb policy that returns up all the time. So one big point of feedback is for students to be able to see what's going on in the environment. So this step through function provides that, and you can see that we start this little orange thing right here is the agent, and it goes up, and students can kind of replay and debug and see, you know, what was going on. So once you have your solution implemented, you can go ahead and run the homework3.evaluate function with your email address that matches Gradescope so that it can enable the security features. And that will take a little bit of time. Just gonna skip forward for you. So that took about 30 seconds to run the evaluation simulations. And you can see we received a pretty bad score, minus 256, because we're always going up. But once you implement MCTS, correctly, you should get a JSON file that looks like this, has your email and a score and a security hash function. And that's what you'll submit to Gradescope. So another big point of feedback is that MCTS is really hard to implement if you can't see the tree when you're debugging it. So we also provide this visualized tree function, and we can load a simple hand-built tree right here. And then just open up a Chrome window, and they have this nice interactive tree that they can explore. So hopefully that gives you a good idea of what a homework looks like. I also want to give a shout out to other Julia packages that students used in final projects, including Jump, Reinforcement Learning, and AlphaZero. Those worked great. And then finally, some lessons I learned. First, it was a good decision for me to use Julia, so I recommend doing it. Second, last year I actually used the MCTS.jl package and had students tweak hyperparameters, but they learned a lot more this year when they implemented it themselves. Third, auto-grading on the student's machine works well using the evaluate function. That cuts down on the upload to Gradescope debug repetition loop. And then finally, you should introduce Julia as the course progresses. So start off with really easy assignments that just use control flow and functions maybe, and then go to more advanced topics later. Finally, a mistake I made was switching tool sets. So I started out on Pluto, did some Jupyter notebooks, and then by the end, I realized the best thing to do was probably just stick with the text editor, REPL, and Electron display. So I want to say thank you to the Julia community for making this all work well, and please reach out to me if you have any questions.